because of the restrictions, but he does get everything. Now, I believe we have some former prisoners right here in the studio, or whatever room we want to call this thing. And you may be wondering why we have these little walls put up on stage. Well, there's a reason for that. When you're sent to prison and you're released, lots of times they kind of want to keep control of you after you get out of prison, and they make all these restrictions on things you can and cannot do. And one of the things you cannot do is converse with other people who have been in prison. So the only way we could bring you this panel tonight would be if these people that are here have no knowledge of the other people that are there and are at no risk whatsoever of communicating with them. So I ask for cooperation in this, that that you know, people are not communicating between the two of these people. Let's see if they're here. Okay, over there on the left, I see Bernie S. And he is approaching the stage. Bernie S., welcome to Beyond Hope. And of course, we've been following your case for quite some time. And you settle in there while I walk over to this side here and try not to listen to anything I say. On this side over here, we have Phiber Optik, who during the last Hope conference was imprisoned. In fact, we heard from him on the telephone. And are you going to stand up, or are you just going to sit over there? Okay. Just come over to the stage here. Don't look this way. Don't look this way. Sit. Okay, look that way. Yes. Look straight ahead. Now, any questions that either of you have, please direct towards me and the audience members. We're going to start with a brief statement by Bernie as to what happened to him over the past few years, and then we'll get the same from Phiber Optik. And I'll tell you, Phiber Optik, when I want that statement from you, since you're not supposed to listen to Bernie, who you don't even know is there. Go ahead, Bernie.
Hello.
How you doing?
I'm glad I'm up here on the stage, just you and me. What do you want me to say?
Well, tell us when you first went into prison, and why, and how long it took you to get out of prison. Now, I know this story can take hours to tell.
Well, I want to abbreviate.
But basically, we're looking for a very, very brief synopsis here, and we'll get into more details and take some questions afterwards.
Okay. In March of 94, I was arrested at gunpoint by six Secret Service and Haverford Police Department detectives while I was replacing a hard drive in a lady friend's computer at the time. She was rather surprised to see six guys come to her door after she just put her children to bed, and six guys came bursting in with guns drawn and ran upstairs and pointed them at me and told me to freeze. So I was kind of taken aback, thrown to the floor, and handcuffed. And I asked what I was charged with, and I wasn't told immediately. I was interrogated by a Secret Service agent and really declined to say much to him, continually asking for my lawyer, who I was told that I was not permitted to call. My rights were read to me, however, though. And spent the night in a holding cell in Delaware County, Pennsylvania. And next morning taken to prison, where my bail was set at $100,000. I was charged with the possession of a modified touch-tone dialer. You can buy a touch-tone dialer at any Radio Shack store. And it was modified with a different crystal, which can also be purchased at any Radio Shack store. Two parts anybody can buy anywhere in the country. I was charged with the possession of that.
I'm on it.
Thank you. Hope that's not a bad omen. Hey, just hold it right there, Emmanuel. It's good. I think we lost the...
We have a maintenance crew up here, please. A legal emergency.
How about some more gaffer's tape? More gaffer's tape, please. Thank you. My bail was set at $100,000, and I was, as I said, charged with two things. The possession of, the technical description of the crime, it was a Pennsylvania misdemeanor 2, possession of a device for theft of telecommunication services. And the other charge I was charged with was a felony 3, unauthorized use of a computer. That charge wasn't really described well in the arrest warrant. I feel like there's a sword of Damocles over my head. So I was arraigned the next morning, and the local judge saw no evidence at all, even though it wasn't even his job to find any evidence. He saw that there was nothing in the affidavit that said I'd accessed any computer at all. The police department's argument was that because I had something that could modify tone dialer, and because the telephone system and the telephones are connected to the a computer network that's largely controlled by computers, that using such a device would constitute unauthorized access of a computer, even though there was no allegation in the affidavit or the arrest warrant that I'd used at Redbox. So anyway, the judge just said, well, I can't even arraign him on this felony charge because there's nothing even presented in the warrant for it. So I was left with a misdemeanor 2 charge, but the bail was still set at $100,000, which I didn't happen to have on hand at the time. So I was taken to a Delaware County prison, a rather filthy place, and my preliminary hearing was delayed twice, and I was there for over a month before I finally had my preliminary hearing, at which point the state dropped its charge, and the Secret Service announced they were going to file federal charges against me. And at that time, I was charged by the Secret Service officially with possession of... Well, actually, the crime was a Title 18, Section 1029, A6B, which I'd never heard of and my attorney had never heard of. And the reason we'd never heard of it is because the law was so new it had not been published in the law books yet. Turns out I was the first person in the country charged with it. And after some research, we found out that it said that it's now a federal felony to possess hardware or software for the modification of telecommunications instruments for the unauthorized access of telecommunication services. And all the criminal complaint from the feds said that that equipment consisted of an IBM laptop computer, various cables, and a computer disk, which contained an application that allowed someone to program cellular telephones. I programmed them with new phone numbers and electronic serial numbers. There was no allegation in the criminal complaint that I'd used this to program any cellular phones at all for any purpose. But I did meet the definition of the statute. So I was transported by the Secret Service, arrested at the prison after I was taken back there from the preliminary hearing, and taken by the Secret Service back to Philadelphia, where the federal building is. And this was a week after the Oklahoma City bombing. And as we pulled into the building, all these lights started going off and sirens going off. Apparently there was a bomb threat against the building as I came in with them. I was handcuffed in the back seat. So we had to leave the building and wait outside a couple blocks away for 2 hours while the building was evacuated. Apparently there were a lot of copycat bomb threats at the time, right after the Oklahoma City thing. So we waited for about 2 hours. And finally was taken back in the building and processed by the Secret Service and the U.S. Marshals. I was Agent Thomas Varney with the United States Secret Service. Unsuccessfully fingerprinted me 16 times. I was actually cooperating with him, but he couldn't seem to get it right. And after the 17th attempt, he said, well, that's going to have to be good enough. And he just threw all the other ones in the trash. He was pretty disgusted. My legal papers and notes, defense notes, were confiscated by him, and I was told that my attorney could pick them up from him later, and I was taken before a federal judge. This judge had just gotten back into his chambers after having to evacuate the building for 2 hours while the place was searched for a bomb, which was a false bomb threat, apparently, fortunately. And Secret Service's first argument was that I was a danger to, the only reason they can hold you without bail is if you're a threat to the community or if you're at risk of flight. Well, the Secret Service argued that because some of the books in my house, I had about 2,000 books, because some of them, I think it was the count was three, but they didn't say how many, three of the 2,000 books I'd had were about how explosives were made. And when the judge heard that, he lowered his glasses and looked at me and said, "No bail." It was a tenuous time for government officials, and I think they were all pretty paranoid about explosives. I'm not a bomb builder. I read all kinds of strange texts, but that was the bad time to be caught with the wrong kinds of books. I didn't know it was illegal or dangerous to have books, but apparently it is now. So I was locked in a holding cell at the U.S. Marshals there at the building, waiting to be transported to the federal facility in Ferreton, New Jersey. And while I was in the holding cell, there were some other prisoners there who told me that during the time that the building had been evacuated because of the bomb threat, that they'd been left in the cell, and that U.S. Marshals had evacuated it with everyone else, and the prisoners were just left in there. So if there had been a bomb, they would have been amongst the rubble, I guess. So a couple hours later, we were transported in an armored van a couple hours away to Ferreton, New Jersey, and it was a pretty amazing sight seeing this facility. It had very high, looked like 14-foot high razor wire ensconced fences, two of them about 10 feet apart, with all kinds of electronic sensors on them, surrounding a big facility. It kind of looked like a college campus, except all the buildings were like heavily armored. And I was brought in there. It was pretty imposing looking. And that began my 7-month period in federal prison. How are we doing on time, Emmanuel? Emmanuel?
Yeah, I'm sorry.
How are we doing on time? Are you falling asleep there on the other side of the wall?
No, I'm fine. It's just that you've been through a lot, and we need to just get a really sketchy outline of what it is that you went through, because there are more things that we have to talk about that you don't have to know about.
How about just talking about some of the experiences I had in prison?
Well, if you could just give us a timeline.
Okay.
When you were first arrested and when you were finally released and what it was that you were arrested for and released for, and then we can move on to some more detail in just a little bit.
Okay.
It's very sketchy.
I was I spent a few months there, and I was held in the facility that's reserved for pretrial inmates, and everyone there has to wear orange jumpsuits. We're called carrots by the guards because we look like carrots running around, and they don't have all the same privileges that people who are designated to that facility have. Apparently, they don't have the same access to the law library and that sort of thing. Ironically, but I managed to get some access to the law library, which wasn't a bad library, but there was not much guidance on how to use it. I witnessed two stabbings, one of them fatal, numerous fights, which ended in severe injury. What else did I see? I was housed in the same housing unit with murderers, arsonists, drug kingpins, organized crime figures. At the time, there was a celebrated case in Philadelphia of a big organized crime bust, and I was held with those fellows. That was kind of interesting. One thing I will say about federal prison, there's a lot of interesting people there, for better or worse. I accidentally dropped a garbage can lid on the head of this organized crime family one day. Off the second tier as I was throwing out some banana peels that my cellmate kept leaving in the cell. And I balanced the lid on the ledge and apparently fell off about 10 feet and hit this guy in the head. I thought my troubles were over then, that I was going to be dead the next day. And he started screaming at me in Sicilian, and his bodyguard there, who was also arrested with him, intervened and said that, you know, I wasn't really trying to hurt him intentionally. And that blew over, but it was a scary situation. After a few months going through various hearings that were basically unsuccessful in getting me out on bail, It looked as if the government had a good case against me. I did possess this stuff, and there was no way around it. There was no allegation I'd misused this material in any way.
Bernie, what was this stuff?
The stuff was a laptop computer, software, cables, and then later they tacked on another charge, possession of the touch-tone dialer that had been modified. Those were the charges. The charges were not that I had used any of this material in any way, shape, or form to commit any other crime.
But was there anything unusual about the stuff that you had?
Well, it was not unusual to anybody in this room, probably. This is software that was available to anyone that attended Hope here in New York 3 years ago, because I gave that software free away to people there and even spoke about its use. It could be used to have more than one telephone on the same number. If you had one phone account, you could have several cellular phones on that. It did not, contrary to what the government argued, give you the ability to steal telephone service from another person, because it didn't enable you to access someone else's account codes, or electronic serial numbers. But that's another subject. The government's very good at being disingenuous when they represent the facts in these cases, and that was one of those instances. So nothing was terribly unusual. You could buy any of this stuff really at any computer or electronics store, and the software is readily downloadable over the internet. About a couple weeks before my trial date, my attorney, who I spoke with on a pretty regular basis, told me that the prosecuting attorney, the U.S. attorney in my case, confided in him that the real reason that I was in jail was not because of crystals or laptop computers or telephone dialers, but was because of what they found in my personal files at my home, which consisted of hundreds of subjects, one file folder of which contained information about the United States Secret Service. And that included photographs of some of their undercover agents who served the Philadelphia area. Those photographs had, some months before, ended up on television after I took them to a 2600 meeting, and the Fox television news crew showed up and broadcast them on the air. We thought it was kind of funny at the time, but I guess the Secret Service did. And one of the pictures had one of the agents picking their nose. It's available on the 2600 website.
So you were arrested in, what was
it, March 15th.
1995. And by the time you were released, you had been sentenced to how long for the offense of having that technology?
Well, the statutory maximum is 15 years in prison for this. But the guidelines, a few years ago, the federal judges were constrained as far as their flexibility and what they could sentence people to, because I guess the House and Senate Republicans were upset that people were getting out earlier than they should in some cases. So they had some truth in sentencing legislation passed, which basically said that the government will put together a book with guidelines that the judges have to follow, like in certain circumstances the sentence has to be this long or this short sort of thing. And the statute I was charged with, even though it was a brand new statute and I was the first person in the country charged with violating it, it was called a fraud statute. But because there was no fraud alleged to have occurred, i.e., the government admitted in their reports that there were no victims in the case, that there was no money involved at all. Because it was a fraud case and there was no money involved, the maximum time they could have given me was 6 months. It was a 0 to 6 month range that was in the sentencing guidelines. So 6 months had come and gone, and I was like, here I am, passed what the government recommends that I could, the government sentencing guidelines say I should be in for. So, I had an evidence suppression hearing because I felt some of the evidence was seized illegally, but that was struck down. And the next day, my lawyer said, listen, the wind is just not blowing the right way. You're better off pleading guilty to violating this statute. But we'll make a special plea called a Zudik plea, which will allow you to withdraw that guilty plea, which is very difficult or impossible to do in federal cases. They usually want you to, a guilty plea is etched in stone. But because this is a new statute, and I was arguing that the wording of the statute, which is very vague, was so vague that it was unconstitutionally vague, and it didn't specify what conduct was really being prohibited. It didn't specify what modified or altered meant, or what a telecommunications device was, or even who had the power to say what is authorized and what's not authorized insofar as access to telecommunication services. I pled guilty with the understanding that I could withdraw my plea and file a challenge in the Third Circuit. For some reason, I wasn't sentenced right away to my time served. I ended up spending another month in prison, and it turns out that when I finally did go before the judge for sentencing, the government was arguing that because the offense involved more than minimal planning, according to them, that I deserved an additional enhancement to that sentence. In the federal sentencing guidelines, there's all these enhancements, like if there's a gun involved, there's an enhancement, but I have no guns in my house, so that wasn't an issue. There's like 20 or 30 enhancements they have, they call them. Nice word. One of them is if there's more than one victim, if there's multiple victims, or if there was more than minimal planning in the offense, and there were no victims, they said there were no victims, that you can get an additional 2 months tacked on to your sentence. Well, turns out that all the planning that they said was involved in my offense occurred prior to the enactment of the legislation that I was charged with violating. But still, the judge bought the argument, and I received a 7-month sentence. So I served the extra time and was released.
And your troubles were over?
Well, I thought they were. Unfortunately, about 2 years before that, I was convicted of a misdemeanor in a small town a couple hours from Philadelphia. The misdemeanor was a tampering with evidence charge. It involved, I was with a couple of friends, and we were questioned by police about tone dialers that were in our possession. And we were released, but after we were released, the police discovered that the instruction sheets on how to make these modify these tone dialers disappeared. And they wanted to know what happened to them. The batteries disappeared too. That thing dragged out for a few months back in 92 and 93, and I eventually pled no contest to it. It was not I who removed the instruction sheets of the batteries, but I was not about to rat out my two friends or two acquaintances who were with me at the time.
So, Bernie, I hate to rush you through this, but we do have other things to get
okay.
to. But basically what happened was the Secret Service found out about this.
Yeah.
Happened, this minor thing that happened a few years ago. They used that to say that you had violated your probation by being
right.
arrested in 1995.
The federal conviction constituted violation of probation for that previous misdemeanor charge. And the state guideline was that in that situation, because it was such a minor misdemeanor charge, that you should just get probation again or up to 3 months in prison. But the Secret Service showed up at this small town courtroom and said a lot of things that made me sound like, in the words of the judge, one step above a terrorist. And that's what the judge said.
Does that mean you're more dangerous than a terrorist?
I was trying to figure that out, whether that meant I was like more dangerous than a terrorist or slightly less dangerous than a terrorist. But in any case, it made quite an impact on the judge because those were his words that he said that the Secret Service painted me as being someone one step above a terrorist. Even though there was nothing dangerous found in my house, the only thing that could have been conceivably dangerous was what the Secret Service described as C4 plastic explosives, which they admitted turned out to be dental putty because the previous owner of the house turned out to be a dentist and there was all these old things in the basement. But they said that while the Secret Service claimed that while it tested not as C4, the fact that it might have been concerned them greatly, and a lot of other misrepresentations like that. So I received a 6 to 24 month additional sentence for this tampering with evidence charge, which the district attorney up there said, as far as he's concerned, it was a victimless crime, the disappearance of these instruction sheets, the same kind of instruction sheets that are printed in 2600 magazine and on the internet. And after that, I was transferred to various other maximum security facilities. The strange thing in my case is that I was sent around into 5 different maximum security prisons. At that point, when I was reincarcerated for that misdemeanor 2 charge, which on the severity scale is equivalent to scattering rubbish in Pennsylvania as far as the crime scoring, my bail was set at $250,000 cash bail. When they say cash bail, that means you can't put up 10% security for it. So it was really the equivalent of $2.5 million bail for what the sentencing guidelines called for probation. But the Secret Service apparently has a lot of influence over judges, especially judges in small towns. And the Secret Service took advantage of that influence and managed to get me sent to not only a fairly bad county prison, but because my bail was set at the equivalent of $2.5 million, locked in the same small wing with multiple murderers and rapists and some, you know, really nasty characters. So that began another whole ordeal. I was then later transferred to two or three other maximum security facilities. And near the end of that whole thing, something happened that I discussed yesterday. I won't go into the details about. I filed a grievance against the assistant warden at one of these facilities for a violation of my rights in one situation. And as a result of doing that, instead of facing the facts in the case, that warden had me transferred to the Supermax facility up in Allentown, Pennsylvania, where in less than 12 hours, I was severely beaten and by another inmate who had just been locked up. I don't think the Secret Service orchestrated that, but the fact that I was sent to this extremely high security facility, I think had something to do with it. I spent 7 hours in major surgery, had 52 stitches stitched into me, got a titanium bar in my left arm now, and multiple pieces of metal in my jaw, which was fractured in three places.
And, while you were being operated on, you were handcuffed to the hospital bed.
I was not only handcuffed, but my ankles were shackled to the gurney in the operating room. That's the last thing I remember before I went unconscious after the general anesthesia. And when I woke up, the next day after coming out of the coma-like condition that general anesthesia gives you, puts you in, I found myself also still handcuffed and shackled to the gurney in the recovery room. So I couldn't even adjust the oxygen mask that was on my face that was pinching my nose because I was shackled and handcuffed, and the guard didn't seem very responsive as far as my complaints. He was just more interested in watching sitcoms on the TV and playing them very loudly, which prevented me from sleeping after I awoke out of my anesthesia. But the nurses felt that they couldn't do much about it because he was a prison guard and he could do what he wanted in there. So at that point, your magazine and your readers and listeners to your radio program, I think, got so upset about what was happening that the campaign that you helped mount eventually got me released. I was already past my parole date at that point, but hadn't been interviewed yet for some mysterious reason. And I think if it weren't for those injuries, I wouldn't have gotten out when I did. The protests that were planned and the torrent of faxes and phone calls to prison officials and politicians that were worked in that part of Pennsylvania, I think played a big part in the judge signing an emergency order that I'd be released for medical reasons. And my jaws were wired shut, and I couldn't speak, I couldn't eat food. I had to, drip liquids into my mouth and let them seep through the gaps in my teeth. Mind you, right after surgery, after getting out of the hospital and thrown into an infectious disease ward in the prison, where people with tuberculosis and hepatitis were routinely held. I didn't know that broken jaws and arms were infectious, or at least I didn't know they were contagious, but the prison officials apparently put everybody in the same category that way. I wasn't even given any pain reliever. In the hospital, I was on morphine for one day, then taken back to the prison, and against both of my surgeon's orders, I was not given any pain medication. And I think that was the worst part of my experience is I remember lying in bed with multiple fractures without any pain reliever, and I learned the true meaning of physical pain then. I got pretty depressed then too, because I couldn't eat and the guards would bring me solid food. The first night, they brought me a stuffed pepper to eat, and I couldn't even eat because of the pain, but even if I had any appetite, which I didn't, there's no way I could have eaten a stuffed pepper. It was my jaws were completely wired shut. The best I could do was sip like chicken broth, and it was a full 24 hours before they brought me any liquid food. So anyhow, it's about a week or so after that that your efforts and the efforts of your listeners to your radio program and to the readers of your magazine and to the mailing list and news group you set up made enough impact to get me released. So I was released, and it took me about a month to recover from not totally recover. This is about as much as I can straighten my left arm out. Straighten my other arm out fine, but that's where the titanium bar is and where the joint was damaged. And I can't open my mouth as much as I would like to. But glad to be alive, and I'm glad to be out, and I'm happily living in Philadelphia now. Have a good job, have a nice apartment, and trying to put this whole thing behind me. But what I'm afraid of most is this happening to someone else, being incarcerated and going through the hell I went through for something the government admitted there were no victims in, and not one dime's worth of fraud occurring in.
Well, the real reason was because you embarrassed some Secret Service agents.
This again was confirmed by the prosecuting attorney, who told my attorney. My attorney worked with this prosecutor as a federal prosecutor himself for 4 years. After 4 years, I think he saw the light and became a defense attorney. And my attorney also has a very good reputation. He successfully argued a case before the United States Supreme Court at one time also. So he's no, first attorney was terrible, I fired him. But this is the attorney that I had a couple months into my case, Kenneth Trujillo out of Philadelphia. So it's a really a good attorney. And his argument again was that I challenged the constitutionality of the law, which we did, but unfortunately he said the appeal he filed had to be kind of a bare bones appeal because he didn't have the financial resources, and neither did I, to put his full staff on it. One thing you'll learn if you ever go through a federal or any kind of other criminal case, especially federal, you need a lot of money, and when I'm saying a lot of money, you need on the order of tens of thousands of dollars to mount an effective campaign. The government usually spends that much money in prosecuting the case, if not more. That's your tax money. And they have, you know, the best expert witnesses that money can buy. And in order to combat those witnesses, you have to hire your own expert witnesses, which are very expensive. You need to have a staff of technically well-versed lawyers to go over all the case law. In my case, there was very little case law because I was the first person in the country charged with this thing. But bottom line is my appeal was turned down because, as my lawyer explained to me, he said they rubber-stamped it. They swallowed the government's argument whole. He said they swallowed it whole. And I'd like to make that appeal available to people. I'll get it posted on the internet sometime soon, but it goes into a lot of the details of why the statute is so vague that it could literally be used selectively to probably incarcerate most of the people in this room. I'm not saying that's going to happen. In fact, I don't think it's going to happen. But when you have a vague law like that, it opens the possibility for abuse. And in my case, with the Secret Service, according to my prosecutor, who confided in my attorney this, she was heavily pressured by the Secret Service to vigorously prosecute this case. And she said the real reason I was in prison was, again, because of the information I had in my files. Also, two Secret Service agents visited the individual who gave me these photographs and told him, and I'll quote them, "Nobody fucks with the Secret Service without us fucking with them. And with 2,000 agents, we're the biggest gang in town." And that's a quote. The individual gave me those photographs that he was visited, and that's what they told him. So he closed his business and moved to California. And they didn't charge him, fortunately. All he did was give me some photographs, but that's a whole other story.
Well, so, Bernie, I think all of us here feel that we're very fortunate to have you here with us after all that.
I really doubt I would have been able to maintain my sanity. I went through a period of depression while I was incarcerated, especially after my injuries. And if I didn't know that a lot of people didn't care and were sending me mail telling me to hang in there, that they were following my case, I probably would have gone into an abyss that I might not have ever climbed out of. So I was looking at some of the printouts you'd given me of the newsgroup postings, and I actually shed a couple of tears looking at over that stuff a couple of days ago. I kind of shelved all that stuff because it was just so painful dealing with the whole situation. I didn't want to think about it much. I tried to kind of forget about the whole experience, but in preparing for this conference, I dug all the stuff out and started reading it, and I was just so touched that people felt so strongly about what was happening to me as being wrong, and I'm never going to forget that. That's one thing I can tell people. If you know anyone who's going through something like this, they're going to need all the support, moral and emotional support you can muster, because it's a rough experience to go through. It's the best description I could manage to come up with for your radio program once was it's like a combination of Alice in Wonderland and Franz Kafka, because nothing in the world of the criminal justice system really is logical. Logic, compassion, and common sense simply aren't even part of the equation. And if that doesn't seem to make sense to you, then just ask someone who's gone through it, and they'll tell you the same thing. So thank you, everybody, all of you people who followed my case, who wrote me, who didn't write me, but were just there for me morally, just in private. All the good vibes you sent me, I think, got through those thick steel walls, and it made the difference for me. Thank you very much.
Okay, Bernie, we're going to put you on hold for just a little bit. There is a third case tonight to discuss, and I believe he's still there. Okay. Phiber Optik is to my right. Welcome, Phiber.
Thank you.
Now, 3 years ago at the first Hope Conference, Phiber Optik was in prison. A lot of us felt very badly having a conference without him being able to attend, and we were brightened a little bit by having him call us live for the first time in the closing night of that conference. And we were actually able to talk to him, ask him some questions, things like that. This year it's much better. This year he's here, still under some restrictions. But, let's just hear your story now. Oh, when did it all begin?
Oh, where should I begin? There's a lot I can say.
Begin where you went wrong in the eyes of the government.
Begin where I went wrong. Okay. I was about nine. No. I went wrong when in January of 1990 was probably the turning point of events. On January 24th, I remember that evening I was coming home from an internship that I had in high school, and I was hanging out with a friend of mine, actually a bunch of friends of mine, from my old neighborhood where my parents live in Queens. And one of my friends said, something really strange is going on around your house. There's all these vans and cars pulled up in the front and around the back. So I thought that was kind of odd. Eventually I went home. It was about dinner time and I was kind of hungry. And I walked in the door, and I didn't see anybody. And I walked into the kitchen, and my mom was on the telephone. And before I could ask her what was going on, there was a knock on the door. And so I walked back to the front door, and I opened the door, and there was some Secret Service agent person's body filling the doorway, and explaining that they had already seized all my things, and that they wanted to question me, and they had been waiting outside. They came in and they proceeded to sit down with a couple of people from 9X and an individual from Belcor in New Jersey. And my parents were really upset that they were trying to question me. I was 17 at the time. I was a minor, and I obviously didn't have any attorney present. From what I could tell of what they were saying before my parents asked them to leave, was they were aware of the fact that I had broken into various systems at within 9X, switching systems, things of that nature, that they were really upset about. And as far as the Belcore guy, I think he was just there as an on-site expert looking over things, and so they knew what they were taking or something like that. Although I had actually had access to Belcore machines in the mid-80s, I was never actually charged for it, but I mean, they had all that evidence, and they chose to charge me with whatever I guess they thought was going to stick. The interesting thing was they accused me of having crashed the AT&T long distance network, which at that time had never happened before. Fortunately, since then, it's happened about 3 more times, or I guess unfortunately, depending who your long distance company is. But at that time, it had never happened before. So they were really upset about it and all worked up. It was I think around January 15th of 1990, or around Martin Luther King Day, that it actually happened. And AT&T soon afterwards made it known that it was their own screw up, but the Secret Service didn't really acknowledge that fact. So they were accusing me of having caused millions of dollars worth of damage, and they kept, every time we asked them, they would make up a different dollar amount, so it became pretty apparent that they didn't really know why they were there or what they were talking about. The obviously the people that knew the most about what was going on were the people from 9X and Belcore, but they didn't really ask me as nearly as many questions as they probably would have wanted to, which was lucky for me, because it's an unfortunate knee-jerk response that when you're doing all this stuff and you finally meet the people that are behind it, your first reaction is that you want to tell them everything because you want them to know where everything's screwed up. So the obvious problem with that is that you'd automatically incriminate yourself in all kinds of horrible ways. So fortunately, they didn't get the chance to ask me all kinds of questions, and so I didn't end up incriminating myself in any way. They left us with a really vague copy of all the things that they had taken, which, you know, was basically anything conceivable that might possibly be electronic, including things that they perceived to be storage medium, including videotapes and things like that, cassette tapes. I got a hold of a couple of the other guys that I was actually, you know, involved in these activities with. I had to find out what had happened, and apparently the same things had happened to them simultaneously. In fact, the agents conducting these searches and seizures were calling each other from between the houses. It was actually a synchronized raid because they were concerned that we would notify the other that this was happening. But it was... That was a pretty harrowing experience, but it was also a pretty confusing experience because we were rather young at the time when it happened. We didn't really know what to make of it, and there was a lot of media exposure at a time when hackers weren't really getting very, very much media attention, not nearly as much as they do today. So all of us as a whole, in general, we're really starved for attention to just get the word out about, you know, what it is we do and who we are. So in some ways, I think we saw getting busted as an opportunity to tell our story. And unfortunately, in a lot of ways, that worked against us because the media was greatly biased in the direction of the government. Excuse me. What ended up happening is, does anybody else hear a hum when I'm talking? Emmanuel, why is it humming while I'm talking?
I'm not in charge of the hum. Maybe our sound person knows
that. I'm getting serious feedback.
Okay, we might be the only ones hearing the hum, so.
Okay. All right, I'll try moving the mic further away. Anyway. After they left, we basically didn't hear from them for another year. And what had happened in the process, since I was a minor, they dropped the charges to state charge. And the state charge was I don't even remember what it was anymore. It was something really minor. It was a misdemeanor. And I was charged as a youthful offender. And I was basically ordered to do, I think it was something like 30 hours of community service. It was something really, really minor. And it was over and done with fairly quickly. Now, that year, the year of 1991, and really the whole time after what initially happened, we were so involved in what it was that we were doing, and we were so convinced that since we had just been busted, that we knew everything that they could possibly do to us. So it was almost as if we were led into a false sense of relief. It's like you know, for 10 years you're living on the edge as a little kid, and you figure, you know, at any given moment, you know, there could be a knock on the door or you know, some federal agents might bust in. And then all of a sudden, it actually happens. It's almost psychologically, it's almost like you convince yourself, well, okay, now the worst is over. I can go back to what I was doing before this happened. So, essentially, we changed our method of operation and redirected our focus on slightly different endeavors. And for the following year, in 1991, we were extremely successful in what it was we were doing. Towards the end of that year, trouble resurfaced. And it was actually the day before Pearl Harbor Day. It was December 6th, 1991. It was a peculiar night. I remember going to sleep at about 4 or 5 in the morning. It was the winter, so it was still dark out. And the neighbor's dogs were making a lot of noise, and the neighbor's car alarm in the back driveway behind my parents' house kept going off. We thought that was kind of peculiar, but nothing out of the ordinary. So anyway, I went to sleep, and I just passed out because I was really tired. I'd been up hacking all night. And in the morning, at about, I think at about 10 or 11 o'clock in the morning, the strangest thing happened. I was awoken by two FBI agents, guns drawn, in my room. And they didn't seem very amused, but the worst part is that I didn't really take them very seriously initially and tried to go back to sleep because I figured that, yeah, it's just completely ridiculous that something like that could be happening. But they weren't really amused, and they pulled the covers off me. They pulled the sheets off, and I normally sleep in my underwears. And they asked me if I had a pair of pants I could throw on, and I motioned across the room, still half awake, and they tossed me a pair of jeans, which I put on, and they marched me down the stairs. And on my way down the stairs, I noticed that The house was filled with scurrying agents like cockroaches. There were FBI and Secret Service agents scurrying in and out of every room on every floor. It was unbelievable. It was like E.T. was dying in my parents' house or something. They were everywhere. It was like they had it sealed off. Apparently what had happened, and I never heard them coming, is they entered through the back door. They went through my parents' backyard, and they had a battering ram, and they literally just busted in the back door and snuck upstairs, I'm sure very quietly, even though they claimed that they knocked, no one answered, and then they proceeded to break in, which is, you know, always the case. But they took me downstairs and they confined me to the living room couch. Basically, I was told to sit on the couch and I couldn't leave the couch. And they proceeded to pack up all my things and little cardboard boxes and take them down and out the front door. And I remember it was an extremely cold day and I was just woken up out of bed. And all I was wearing was a pair of jeans and a t-shirt. one of the people from the media, at this point I had already met with a lot of media people and knew many of them that were there. And one of them handed me a copy of the indictment. And while the indictment was still happening, or rather while this press conference was still happening, me and a couple of friends went over to one of the federal buildings where they assign legal counsel, which in the federal system is slightly different from a public defender. It's similar, but it's a higher classification of attorney, which is provided through what's known as the Criminal Justice Act. Because at that time I was 18, I certainly wasn't working and didn't have the money to hire an attorney. We went over to the building and went to apply for a court-appointed attorney, and the person behind the desk couldn't find any record of the fact that I was in any kind of legal trouble whatsoever, and was questioning why, in fact, I was registering myself for legal aid. And I was trying to explain to her that I was at this very moment being indicted in the building right across the way, and that only confused her, and it just didn't work out. So we went back to the building where they were holding the press conference, and we could hear what they were saying, and a lot of the media people just didn't understand why this was such a big deal. Neither did I, really. The government was trying to make it sound like it was the end of the world, but the media was really looking for where the actual damage was, which there wasn't really any real conceivable damage other than maybe the damage to the pride of the corporations involved. At the end of the press conference, one of the people that walked over to me actually turned out to be the assistant U.S. attorney, and gave me his card and said that I would have to get in touch with him, and also the Secret Service agent in charge of the case. Also came over and said that they were giving me the option to surrender myself, and that they weren't going to take me into custody because apparently I was not a violent person, or so they thought. I got in touch with whoever else wasn't there and wasn't aware that all this was happening. And I told them basically that we had to surrender ourselves or else they were going to come after us by a given date, which I think was within a week. And we basically had to go down out of our own free will and get processed by the Secret Service at the Secret Service headquarters, which is at 6th World Trade Center. And we had to get processed by the FBI, which you don't actually go to the FBI headquarters. Which I could tell you where it is, but they probably wouldn't like that very much because people don't normally go there, or rather people aren't supposed to know where it is. But the FBI actually has you processed by the U.S. Marshal. So, and the U.S. Marshal was actually in the basement of the court building. And so when I say processed, I mean you're basically fingerprinted and photographed and all that nonsense. The funny thing is when I went to be processed in the U.S. Marshal's office, this was around the time that they had just caught the guys who had bombed the World Trade Center, and they were waiting in there too. So I'm basically standing there, and there's there's these half dozen Arab guys that are just babbling to each other in Arabic. And they're just looking at me like I should die for some reason, I guess because I wasn't, I wasn't Islamic or something. So that made me feel really uncomfortable, but there was, there was something really surreal about that. So eventually they took them in, and they took them into a cell, and they seemed to be completely indifferent to what was going on. And ultimately, I was fingerprinted and photographed, and then released. And then some time had passed, and sorry, I'm really thirsty. Some time passed after that, and I'm trying to remember exactly how much time, but one second. Whose throat is dry in here? Is it me? It's really dry in here.
Do you need some water?
I got some water over here. I'm just guzzling some down because I'm choking.
Phiber, if you could zip through your whole prison career in about the next 3 minutes, that would be really nice because we should take some questions.
All right, let's fast forward a little bit. Which basically what I was getting to is that some time had passed and we were notified by mail, all of us, that we were, I got to the indictment part, we were indicted, we were processed. We went through the whole mess of, initially, some of us wanted to go to trial and others that were wanted for more counts in the indictment did not want to go to trial. So we were immediately divided amongst ourselves because obviously those of us with only one or two charges didn't want to necessarily be held under the same responsibility for what had happened as the people that were charged with the bulk of the indictment. So that really divided us, and it got really ugly after a while. I was the only remaining person who had not pled guilty and was preparing to go to trial and just ultimately just threw in the towel because I had weighed the risk, had gotten all the discovery material provided to me of all the evidence that was collected. And I just said that I was facing a conspiracy charge, which carried 2 to 5 years in prison and $250,000 in fines. And in addition to that, I was facing a second charge, unauthorized access to federal interest computers, which was also a felony and carried the same penalty, 2 to 5 years and $250,000 in fines. So even if I was able to convince the jury that one of those things wasn't true, and they convicted me of the other, then I would still go to prison for 5 years, and I would be a really poor man when I got out. So that really didn't seem worth it. So ultimately, I ended up pleading guilty. I was notified by mail, along with everyone else, when we were supposed to report to prison. And basically, of course, this is assuming that we were already sentenced, which we were. And I was quickly sentenced to a year and a day, 600 hours of community service, and 3 years of supervised release. And I was supposed to report to prison in, I believe it was 1994, in January of 1994. And the irony of the whole thing is we went out and stayed at Bernie's that weekend. And we never would have imagined at that time that one day I would be free and Bernie would be in prison. Never really crossed our minds. But basically me and Emmanuel and a couple other of our friends drove out and had a weekend at Bernie's, exactly. Yeah, there was... There's a great snowstorm.
Ice storm.
A great and terrible ice storm that swept through Philadelphia. And it was amazing because there were just blankets of ice on everything, on cars. If they didn't even look like cars anymore, they just looked like lumps of snow and ice. and all the bushes and shrubs were frozen solid, and the streets were just sheets of ice.
We had to crawl through the streets of Philadelphia to find a place to eat. We couldn't stand upright. It was that slippery.
The governor declared a state of emergency and said that no one could legally drive on the streets. So we had a problem.
Yeah.
Phiber had to get to prison, and the governor said you couldn't, and the Fed said you had to.
Yeah, the real problem was I was supposed to report to prison at a particular date, and all the roads were closed, and basically Bernie had contacted the prison and, you know, told him, hey, the roads are closed. How was I supposed to report to prison? And they said, oh, don't worry, just come tomorrow. And then the next day, come tomorrow. Just come as soon as the roads are open. And we ended up actually getting there late on, I think it was either a Friday or a Saturday night.
Saturday night.
Yeah. And unfortunately, and something that they didn't reveal to us was that there's nobody to process you as a new inmate on the weekend. So I was actually taken into the medium security prison that is attached to the prison work camp that I was supposed to go to. I was taken to a place known as the Hole, which I'm sure you've seen in movies on television. The only difference is that when you're put in the hole in real life, you're not naked. There aren't rats running around. Well, sometimes there's rats running around. I shouldn't say that. In the place that I was at, there were not. But you're not naked, and you're not laying on the floor in your own urine in the dark. So that part is a little different. But it is equally as depressing. And I was in this isolation for about a day and a half. Which I found rather maddening, because the only thing you really have to do is look at the halogen spotlights outside your really tiny window, or you could read the scratchings on the wall that were made by some other unfortunate person who was there before you, and you kind of feel like you're in the Twilight Zone episode where Roddy McDowell is in the room that looks like a perfect replica of like a 1960s living room, except they open up the front wall and it's people looking in through a piece of glass, and he's actually in a zoo on a foreign planet. You kind of feel like that, because they feed you through a little hole in the door that they actually unlock, and they shove a tray of food through. excuse me. Thank you. It's good water.
There's still some left outside, you know.
Okay, well, it's not. I got a few more gulps left. It's just very dry up here talking for so long. Anyway, where was I? Oh, being fed through a hole, yeah. So ultimately, I got the same carrot suit that Bernie had described, and I was marched around between buildings in the snow with these really thin rubber-soled shoes, and I was extremely cold. And I often joke around with friends of mine, because when you're actually stripped down naked when you first get there. And one of the things that they ask you to, well, they tell you to do two really funny things with your privates. And one of the things that they tell you, and this is the exact lingo that they use,
They tell you to lift your sack, and then they tell you to turn around and spread your cheeks, and which is something that makes you feel extremely uncomfortable, especially because the two guys telling you to do it are hillbillies from the mountains of Pennsylvania. So that was a very peculiar experience. Luckily, I left the room with my manhood intact, and I was given a thank you. I was given a fresh supply of water. No, I was given one of these very same carrot suits, orange jumpsuit. And I was sent to a building to be photographed. And the really funny part was that it was a Polaroid camera, which are the easiest cameras in the world to use because you load the film, you snap the picture, you pull out the film, you peel off the paper, and you have yourself a picture. Well, for whatever reason, these two particularly swift gentlemen had horrible trouble doing this. And they succeeded in repeatedly putting the film in backwards, not having the camera plugged in when they snapped the film, pulled out the film, and ripped the paper off to reveal a glob of acid on the paper that didn't really look very much like me. So I was in the picture-taking session for quite some time. Ultimately, they were able to successfully photograph me, give me a number, have me repeat the number back to them, which was my inmate number, and fingerprint me and the whole nine yards. And by then it was probably, I'd estimate about 2 or 3 in the morning, and I was getting pretty tired. Let's see, what happened next? Well, okay, by this time I was living in the hole for the remainder of the weekend after I had been processed. After eating something that they claimed was food, and because of the fact that I was already under an incredible degree of stress, on Monday morning, late Monday morning, I wasn't feeling too good, so I decided I was going to walk over to the toilet and proceed to vomit all over it, which made me feel a whole lot better at the time. And then I was sometime later, I was escorted out of the hole and taken over to some other building and given a change of clothes because in the prison camp, you don't actually wear the orange jumpsuit thing anymore. You wear what looks like clothes that weren't good enough to be used on Gomer Pyle because they were defective or too cheaply made or something. But they're basically khaki shirts and khaki pants and some steel-toed boots, which was the standard issue prison wear. So I still have to laugh when I see people in the street that are, you know, wearing Levi's cotton Dockers or something like that, because I think they look like they just came out of prison. And it just looks ridiculous to me. Anybody wearing tan or khaki. But anyway, that's what you normally wore when you were doing work or when you had visits from the outside. Otherwise, you could wear sweatpants, which you had to purchase, or t-shirts and so on. I guess this is where, if things aren't strange enough already, this is the point where things get really strange, because prison life, if you want to actually refer to it as life, is extremely peculiar. There's this whole other language that people use in reference to various things that you're either familiar or totally unfamiliar with. Some of the language is actually a hybrid of, that's really made up of the predominant places that the majority of inmates are from. So for example, a lot of the slang that's spoken in prison is kind of a hybrid between New York City, New Jersey, Philadelphia, and a couple other places, and kind of fused together, along with this other long-standing prison lingo that apparently people take with them when they're transferred from prison to prison. And some of the words are prisoner, were coined by prisoners, but other terms apparently were coined by the Bureau of Prisons. And if you don't really pay attention, pretty soon you start to realize that a lot of these terms were made up with some kind of psychological reasoning behind them. I'm trying to think of some really good examples. Let's say, for example, you're having a problem with another inmate or with the person that you're working for or whatever the problem may be. You fill out a form, what this form is actually called, it's known as a cop-out. And you say, okay, a cop-out, I need to fill out a cop-out. What, am I copping out in some way? I don't really understand. So there's this really weird psychological thing going on that's sort of subconsciously imposed upon you the entire time that you're there. Not to mention the fact that there are what's known as counts at regular intervals, not counting emergency fog counts. Counts are basically head counts, where everybody has to return to their bunk and they have to be accounted for. And then you really see what type of person actually qualifies for a corrections officer is the person who failed basic arithmetic in kindergarten, because you'd be surprised how many times they have to recount. Basically, the way it works is they have two COs, or what the inmates call them is, ironically enough, they call them hacks, H-A-C-K-S, hacks. And I'm not really sure what the origin of that is, why they're called hacks. I've heard some really playful acronyms of what it could stand for. One of them is huge asshole carrying keys is one such acronym. But basically, a couple of the older guys, when I first got there, took me in and showed me the ropes about, you know, things you need to know when you're in prison. For example, you learn very quickly that the only thing that you're ever going to hear in prison that makes a jingling noise is one of these huge assholes carrying keys. So you want to make sure that you're not doing anything that you're not supposed to be doing. If you, by any chance, happen to hear the sound of keys jingling, that's something you learn right away. There's other various things that are particularly strange that you find out about right away. That you wouldn't really assume on the outside, that really make no sense. For example, it's a mortal sin if you're in the dining hall to actually reach over someone else's tray with food on it. I could never really figure out why that was. The only thing I could think of is maybe they're afraid that some kind of like diseased flesh was gonna fall off your body into their food or something like that. Never really could understand that, but I don't know if it's some weird prison superstition or something else, but it's just very strange. I'm trying to think of some of the other things. You're familiarized with, if you ever have a problem, which you never should have a problem, because basically any inmate who does have a problem is putting themselves at risk as a troublemaker and somebody who's going to be shook down every so often and more often than not. Shakedowns are something that's done on a fairly regular basis. They basically go to your locker where you have your personal belongings, and they open it up and they proceed to rifle through all your things looking for what's known as contraband. And contraband could be most anything. I can't really give you any examples because it could literally be anything at all that you're not supposed to have. And the list is endless, and they can literally just make it up as they go along. Like, one day you shouldn't be having too many paper clips or something, or another day you have one too many pairs of socks, and that's considered contraband.
You got in trouble for having too many books.
What's that?
You got in trouble for having too many books.
Yeah, actually, it's also a terrible thing and a horrible transgression against the Bureau of Prisons to have too many books to read. And I could never really grasp what the reasoning was behind that. But initially, when I first got there, I was sent so many books from people on the outside that I was told that I had too many books and I had to get rid of most of them, or else they were going to be confiscated. So rather than letting the prison keep them, I ended up getting a box and mailing them home. But I could literally go on and on and on about all the really bizarre things that occur in these places. But I think let me ask Emmanuel if you think it's appropriate now to start taking some questions.
Yes, if people could line up in the usual spot where we take questions. No pushing and shoving this time, just nice and orderly. And Phiber, maybe we could fast forward to the day that you were released. What was that like?
When I was released, it's very, very interesting. Once you're there that long, the interesting thing is anybody whose sentence was for a couple of months, you don't really get that much respect in prison, because anybody whose sentence was that short usually is an informant of some sort or another, because, or otherwise, why would your sentence be that short? It's highly unlikely that somebody is sentenced to only a couple of months if they were even warranted a prison term. The fact that I was there for a year greatly helped my inter-inmate relationships. And the other thing was the fact that the media was so intent on going to interview me in prison all the time. Before long, everyone knew me, so that really worked in my favor. And I wasn't really screwed around with very often by the prison staff, and not at all by any of the inmates. In fact, majority of the inmates that I knew were extremely friendly with me. And it's strange that when you're there for such a long time, you just kind of get accustomed to the way things are. And when somebody that you know that's been with you the whole time actually leaves, you're really glad that he's leaving and finally going home, but at the same time you're kind of sad to see him go, because, you know, it's one less person that you can play gin with or something like that. And that may seem kind of funny, but you really zero in on the simple things, because you lose so much in prison that it's little things like a card game or a simple conversation with somebody that you smoke a cigarette with. Things like that become really important. And by the time it was time for me to actually leave and go home, it rather snuck up on me and took me by surprise, because, again, you don't really feel like it's time to go home, because after you're there for just about a year, you get kind of used to being there. And you still don't like being there, but you know that you can either come to terms with your current situation, or else you can, you know, make believe that you're insane, or maybe you are going insane, and then, you know, you can go to the prison doctor and get medicated with all kinds of crazy antidepressants, which a lot of people there actually did, which I had absolutely no intention of doing, because let's just say the prison medical plan is not one that you'd want to actually apply for. So one thing you want to make sure you that you don't do when you're in prison is actually get sick. Anyway, by the time it was my time to go, and I should add that I actually refused to apply for a halfway house, which a lot of people actually respected me for as well. I had made up my mind that if I was going to apply for halfway house, I was going to them needing something. And the entire time I was there, I made sure that I never went to anyone who was one of the prison staff needing anything from them. And when I actually walked out of prison, I wanted to be where I walked out the door and went home. I didn't want to be going from one prison to, you know, to a halfway house, which is kind of like you're on the outside, but you're still highly restricted. So I actually opted, out of my own free will, to forgo the halfway house, which they kind of dangle in front of you like a carrot, because they try to blackmail inmates into, you know, doing certain things or putting them in really sticky situations, getting all their hopes built up that they can leave early if they get a halfway house early. I just convinced myself early on that I wasn't gonna fall into that trap, and I actually ended up staying in prison until towards the end of November, just before Thanksgiving, actually. So luckily, I got out just before the holidays, so I was able to have both Thanksgiving and Christmas at home, which was great. But again, it was a really peculiar experience going back home again. I remember my girlfriend at the time picked me up from prison, and we went to town, and I had something to eat, and I remember that what I ordered in the restaurant. It felt really strange to be in the restaurant, because she had brought me a change of clothes. We went to a hotel, and I had a shower, and it felt really weird to have money again, because in prison, obviously, you don't have money. And to actually sit in a restaurant and decide what it was I wanted to eat, and never mind that, but being out in a wide open space and just being able to, you know, walk anywhere I damn well pleased, which was really confusing at first, and was confusing for a number of weeks afterwards. I remember I ordered a grilled chicken sandwich with French fries and a Coke, and and before that, I think I had some kind of soup, and for whatever reason, I remember it was the best damn food I'd ever eaten. The funny thing about that is that prison food all tastes the same. The number one thing that you eat in prison is beans, and everybody eats beans, and everybody's constantly farting all the time because of that fact. And to make matters worse, the guys that weightlift and spend a lot of time bodybuilding, they steal eggs from the kitchen, and so they're constantly eating hard-boiled eggs and eating, you know, meals that are constantly involving beans in some way, shape, or form. So they're even more deadly than everybody else. So I remember that was the first food that I ate. I remember for dinner, my parents had asked me, you know, what it was that I had wanted for dinner when I got back, and I told them on the way back I wanted to get pizza from the favorite neighborhood pizzeria on the way back, as sort of a late lunch, which we did. And then for dinner, I remember my parents made lasagna, which was amazing to eat real lasagna again when I got out of prison. In prison, they actually have lasagna. If there is anyone in the audience who knows what prison lasagna is made out of, then you'll understand why I'm laughing. If there's anyone who doesn't, I'll turn your stomach by telling you. Basically, it's government issue lasagna noodles, whatever the hell those are, and They're basically filled with cottage cheese and chopped turkey meat. And of course, topped with your favorite government-grade tomato sauce. So you can imagine that it was a hot time in the cafeteria when they served lasagna. So it was great to get home and eat mom and dad's lasagna again. That was probably one of the most exciting things that had happened the day I was released. The other strange thing is that everything and everyone looked smaller, and I wasn't really sure why that was. I think that I had grown so accustomed to living in sort of a military environment where you live in like an open barracks, in open cells, where there's a couple of dozen cells in this wide open barracks with double bunk beds on both sides of the barracks with a long narrow walkway going down the middle. And you're just basically used to this open space and really no privacy whatsoever. So I think whenever I felt like I was in a room or in a confined space, it actually felt smaller than it was, which was kind of confusing for a while. But so anyway, that was how things were to the point that I got released. And I admit that I'm a recovering ex-con. And I think I'm doing a fairly good job of it. I'm certainly in a lot better shape mentally now than I probably was when I was first released, or even when I first went to prison, for that matter. But let's take some questions.
Yeah, all right. So let me just point out for those of you giving questions, you have to address your questions to either Phiber or Bernie S., but not both, because
no
they
problem.
Can't have any risk of communicating with each
we
other.
We can ask a question twice then, right?
If you have to, yes, ask it twice.
Independently referring to some anonymous person. Okay. All right, my first question will be a little like that. Bernie, I noticed that you said that you weren't read your rights initially for a number of days, I think. And also, what was it? You also had asked to speak to your lawyer and were denied that right initially and were just ignored. And I also heard that similar stuff happened to another hacker who mentioned that he was asking to ask, or that when his house was raided, there was a search warrant that wasn't even signed, or search warrants arrived late. Are people in, having had some legal experience with all this stuff, are people in this kind of a position who are treated this way? That's government breaking the law, as far as I understand it. Are you able to sue for punitive damages in that circumstance? Microphone.
Bernie?
About three years ago, I would have thought so, but I was pretty naive in assuming that. Apparently, these kinds of blatant violations of civil rights are routine in law enforcement investigations, particularly so when they're local law enforcement agents as opposed to federal. The feds seem reasonably professional, although very good liars, very professional liars in a lot of respect. My original arrest was by a consortium of local and federal law enforcement officers. I did say, no, it's not true that my reds were not read to me when I was arrested. When I was arrested, they were not read to me. It was several hours later that they were read to me. I did say that my rights were read to me then, when I was speaking earlier. But I was not permitted to have my attorney. They were all very excited there at the police station when the Secret Service was questioning me, and when one of the detectives from the local law enforcement agency was questioning me. Because I wasn't going to tell them where I lived. I wasn't arrested at my home. I was at a friend's house, and they coincidentally saw my vehicle. It was a bad coincidence, just a few blocks from the police station. I didn't know there was an arrest warrant out for me. But so the address they had in their records wasn't the address where I was living, because I had just moved a couple of weeks before that. And they demanded to know where I lived, and I said, well, I'd like to talk to my attorney. They said, well, you don't have that option. You have to tell us your address first before we'll let you talk to your attorney. Well, the reason I wanted to talk to my attorney is I wanted my attorney to be there, present at my home, while the search was taking place, because I knew that there was going to be some funny stuff going on, and he should be there. Well, bottom line is they all night spent scurrying around. They finally figured out where I did actually live. A strange thing, the day before I was arrested, my pager went off with my home phone number, which is very strange because I didn't live with anyone. And I never did figure out what was with that, but they confiscated my pager and went through the numbers and did a reverse lookup on it and found that one of the numbers on my pager was, and they checked out all the addresses of all the numbers on my pager and ended up at this one place. My roommate at the place where I was living at that time let them in because he was scared to death. The Secret Service shows up at your door. And they proceeded, without a search warrant of my home, to search the entire house, not just just areas where my roommate gave them permission to search. There's federal case law on this. In an apartment situation, a roommate is not authorized to give permission to law enforcement officers to search another person's bedroom, sort of thing. Well, they just ransacked the whole place. The next morning, they came back with an official search warrant listing all the items that they'd already listed the night before on the things that were there. This was basically rubber stamped by a local judge in Villanova, Pennsylvania, where I was living. And later, police denied ever having been there twice. My roommate, after all this show was over, told me that they were there the night before. They threatened him. They threatened him with jail because he had a non-licensed copy of X-Wing Fighter on his home computer. And they said that if he didn't cooperate, they were going to arrest him for having pirated software on his computer. So they do these tricks, and I think these are pretty routine. But you know, the courts are extremely biased in towards the law enforcement community, and just your word against theirs. And so no, it's not realistic to try to sue them for these things.
Okay, I guess the picture is, in your case, they were just really very determined to screw you.
Well, I don't think it's to screw. It's just they want to. They just want to do a bang up job, I guess. And in this case, the Secret Service was heavily pushing the prosecution because of apparently a personal issue. When I was arrested by the Secret Service after the state charge was dropped, they told me they'd taken one of the two agents picking me up at the county prison, who took me to the federal building, was one of the two agents pictured in the photographs picking their noses, which ended up on television. He told me he took a lot of heat for that, and he made me aware in no uncertain terms that this was getting even. He didn't say that, but it was clear to me that that was his tone of voice.
So how did you initially, what you were charged for ultimately, how did that come to their attention? They couldn't just see these pictures on TV and decide,
no, definitely not,
we're going to go arrest this guy. How did it come to their attention that you had a modified tone dialer and software?
That's a very good question. It's there was a lot of twists and turns in all this. They were not aware that I had anything to do with these photographs being on television until my home was searched and they found those photographs. The reason the Secret Service was involved in the first place in the case is because the local police confiscated from me a box of crystals and unmodified tone dialers that was in my possession. A couple of guys had called me and said, "Well, I want to buy some of these crystals." They'd read in some book that I was selling these crystals mail order for $5.
Is that how you came to the attention of local law enforcement?
Not because I was selling them I've been selling them for years, but a couple of guys called me and said, "Well, meet me at the 7-Eleven. I want to buy a few of these crystals from you." So I was going over across the street from the 7-Eleven was a post office. I had to go over to get my mail anyway. So I went over there, and I was selling some crystals there. And some neighbor called in apparently and thought it was a drug deal going down, or a police officer saw it. And the affidavit said that it was a suspected drug deal going down. So 13 police officers showed up at the scene, and they detained us all for 2 hours while they just searched our vehicles against my consent, I might add. There was no probable cause to search it. They denied that later as well. and the box was seized without my consent, and they did not know it was in the box at the time, which was in violation of law. But later on, even though the police report said that the box was confiscated, they testified under oath that it was given to them with consent. But the judge still went along with them. It's amazing that this stuff happens and they get away with it, but they do routinely.
Okay, let's try to get to some other questions because we're rapidly running out of time.
No problem. All right. I'll
turn it over. Is that Captain Crunch?
Yeah.
How you doing? And who is your question directed towards?
To Mark.
Go ahead.
Phiber Optik. Has anybody contacted you while you've been in jail to ask you for technical information while you were there?
Actually, no. Nobody really ever approached me to do anything for them. Like, I mean, people in general didn't really understand what it is that I did. They understood that I did something along the lines of breaking into computers, kind of like in war games or something like that. You know, it was like without an analogy to refer to, they didn't really know what it was that I did. And if they did have half an idea of what I did, they weren't really sure, you know, how that would help them out in any way. I mean, in general, people didn't really ask me to do anything like make phone calls for them anything like that.
Yeah, because when I was in prison, I was approached by a number of individuals who were very knowledgeable in phone technology. And I thought maybe that you might run across some of those same people as well. Thank you.
Okay, this will be our last question. Go ahead.
Phiber, I'd like to find out some information on the conditions of your release and what kind of restrictions you're still under.
I'm not under any restrictions that are outside the scope of ordinary supervised release. There's nothing in my supervised release that has anything to do with computer or technological restrictions. I can't associate with any known felons, which is a regular restriction. I can't travel without permission out of the state, which is a typical restriction. I don't have any kind of weird restrictions like some of the things they've been trying to pull on people recently, like not being able to use the internet or anything like that. There's nothing like that.
Okay, I want to thank both of you for being here today.
Emmanuel, I wanted to say one quick thing before we wrap this up.
Go ahead.
In Mark's case, and it fortunately didn't happen in, well, actually it did happen in my case and in Mark's case, the reason a lot of people go to federal prison and other county prisons, aside from what they're charged with doing, the prosecution's cases are often made much easier because of informants or people who come forward with information about the defendant. I know that happened in Mark's case, and it did happen in mine as well. I want to give you some quick statistics. In the federal prisons, in the U.S. federal judicial system, 97% of the cases that are brought forward, 97% of indictments result in convictions. That's a phenomenal success rate. 95% of those cases never make it to trial. And that should tell you a couple of things. And that is that a whole lot of prosecutions are being meted out without trials. And the reason for that is that the federal sentences are potentially so long that people get really scared that they're going to spend, you know, years and years in prison, and will generally rat out anybody they're involved in any kind of activity that the government feels is illegal, and will get off with minimal or no sentence at all. I just want to tell people that a lot of people are going to jail unnecessarily as a result of people not just learning to say, talk to my lawyer. It's really unfortunate. We wouldn't have this kind of conviction rate on hackers, or other people for that matter, maybe who should be in prison. But in any case, in these kind of crimes where there's like no, when there are no victims involved, no one is hurt, the hacking community really needs to learn this, that everyone will be best served in this community by simply not ratting out their fellow hackers. Over the past few years, this has gotten a lot worse. People are simply stumbling over each other to rat each other out, and we're all losers as a result of this. And we'll, you know, maybe one person will serve less time, but it's extremely self-serving. And you know, you have to hang together in all this. So I just wanted to make that statement because it's a disturbing trend, and people need to learn this.
Okay, I just want to say the two of you are probably two of the most inspirational people in my life. I'm proud to have you both as friends, and I'm really glad that both of you are out today with us here. Thanks so much for being with us. And coming up next, we'll be having the Root panel, followed by the grand finale to Beyond Hope, so don't wander away.
Frankie was a mook from the block we used to live on. I wanna be the gangster, the wanna be the dapper Don. Don John, on the wall, I said, now I'm your biggest fan, next to my little brother Paul. He's losing his grip, man, like Pesci, he flip. And you talk to his brother, said he always made his trip. He was an okie dokie, run around like Don Quixote, trying to free a man, he didn't even know me. He had the roots, and he bought the suits, and the boys didn't like him, to tell you the truth. Yeah, he had JG on his pinky ring, and he lied about some doing some time up at Sing Sing. Flip one fine summer afternoon, told his brother Paulie summer had to be done soon. He took Paulie and a couple of boys, and decked the coupe de ville.